During the 7 years, Belmont celebrated 3 on its own. It was passed on to the spiritual Baptist faith. Wherever there are spiritual Baptist practitioners, this celebration is scheduled for the third Saturday of January annually. Collaboratively, there are celebrations underway in the United States, Canada, Barbados, Trinidad and Tobago. Be one of the countries that started spiritual Baptist. It is historic for us to celebrate spiritual Baptist International Youth Day. On behalf of the Apostolic Patriarch, Dr. Nurse B. Ashton, and the Patriarch Aides, may I take this opportunity to welcome you all here to the Spiritual Baptist International Youth Day. It would be remiss of me not to thank our ancestors, leaders, mothers, and every spiritual saint who went through every part of the turmoil to open the way for our faith. Today, I would like to applaud the youths to show our leaders and even our parents they are not invested in vain. Whatever is our strong point, use it today. Sing, shout, play the drums. May this faith continue to help us grow spiritually and carnally into the fine young educated people. Leaders, we look and learn from you, so please keep inspiring and encouraging us to stay active and involved in this wonderful faith that we share in fellowship. Brethren, be encouraged by God's word. I am thy vine, ye are thy branches. Ye that abide in me, I am him. The same bring forth much fruit. For without thee, ye can do nothing. God bless you, keep you, and may this light continue to shine upon you. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. The spiritual Baptist faith is a Caribbean Afrocentric religion. It is like a computer. What you put in is what you receive. Some of our belief system has been misinterpreted so that we are not seen for who we are, but a carbon copy of someone else. Our rituals and practice has been invaded because we do not know how to properly identify with our own culture. We try to fit in with other society. Therefore, but that in itself is out of step. We no longer believe in mourning and healing. We feel that we can read a book and it is done. Some of us refuses to go on the threshing floor or the mourning ground because we condemn it after going to school. I believe we are losing the essence of who God is and this noble faith of ours. The steps of walking to the beach for baptism was one that you will never forget, because there's marks of bruises, so you remember it's not for form or fashion. As the songwriter wrote, "It's not for fame our prayer shall be, but gladly we will toil and suffer, only if we walk with God." At this step, we set ourselves apart to go into the inner court to seek the face of God. Our prayer lines are to be open on a daily basis, but at times it's only been done when we are on the run or when we are in trouble. But forget where we came from and looking into a direction that is no benefit to us. At some point, we place full emphasis on dancing, and most of the time we don't know how to dance to our own beat. We get so jealous and not zealous of other people's beat, rather than hearing from God through the written and spoken word. We listen to other voices, as the scripture states, "My sheep know my voice, and a stranger they will not follow." We no longer go on the wayside and preach so that we can warn the people of the destruction that will come upon us. We are now confined to the four walls of a building that we call church, and those to hear the word are now deprived of hearing. Some of us no longer practice the ringing of the bell that harmonizes the church. At times it is a show to see who can ring a better bell. If our prayer line is not open, we are out of step. Our language changes because we want to feel or be a part of it, and when that happens, we are out of step. We at times refuse to greet our elders with respect. We want to bring the world into the church instead of carrying the church into the world. In conclusion, we must be proud of this faith, especially at times like this when God called us to be the Nehemiahs and the Esthers of today. We must walk in steps so that we will not regret being a part of this indigenous religion of our forefathers. Therefore, we will not feel envious of other religions, for we are fully persuaded that Christ died for us and that we are joint heir with Christ. Therefore, we are no longer strangers. Be reminded, church, knowing that this is what we are called to, spiritual Baptist faith. Thank you, and God bless.
Thank you. who is and shall ever be the head of my life, thanking him for his son, Jesus the Christ. And today my heart is filled with joy unspeakable and full of glory to be an ambassador for Christ and an evangelist of his gospel, saying me to his word. Go ye into all the world and preach my gospel. And so I am here to speak to you as a servant and brother. My topic today is, to what purpose are we called? To understand such a topic, first you must know, who am I and where do I come from? When we as children ask, why do we look different to other humans? What are the answers? In my research, I realized, first you must acknowledge that we are fully, fearfully and wonderfully made. The human race is a creation of Almighty God. But again, why are we different looks? Look at our skin, our hair, our nose, and our mouth. To answer such, we must look at the major influence, our environment. The world acknowledges that the cradle of mankind is the continent of Africa. Scientists have done studies using the DNA of every race, and they have all been linked to one female, an African woman, who walked the earth about 2,000 years ago. Hence, there is only one human race. Evidence demonstrates that the oldest human remains have been located in East Africa, in the Rift Valley. Most people now believe that all humanity originated in Africa, and that is where the Garden of Eden was found. This means that all humans originated look the same way black people do now. The continent of Africa experiences several different climates and conditions, as the Tropic of Cancer, the Equator, and Tropic of Capricorn all occur through Africa. Climates vary from tropical rainforests, savannas, and deserts to Sahara. It is the place where its tallest mountain peak of Kilimanjaro has snowed all year round. The major factor about Africa is that the climate in the majority of areas is hot and humid. Therefore, people who live in that region need to have special protection against the sun and heat. Melanin is a natural dark pigment that gives fair skin and the eyes its color. Skin color is determined largely by the amount of melanin in the outer layer of the skin. In sunny climates, close to the equator, natural selection has favored dark melanin-rich skin, which protects against the absorption and emission of harmful ultraviolet rays before they penetrate to the lower layers of the skin. It is important to note that some ultraviolet light must penetrate the skin so that the body can produce vitamin D. Thus, at higher latitude or altitude, where sunlight is less intense, pale skin with little melanin is the norm. Eye coloring is determined primarily by the concentration and distribution of melanin pigment on the iris fibers. The human eyes appear blue when there is no melanin in the outer iris and turns darker as the melanin increases. In the iris, as in the skin, melanin absorbs light, protecting the eye from glare. Thus, dark eyes generally favored by nature. In Europe, however, about almost 50% of the population has blue, green, or gray irises. Such people may see further in the dim light, but scientists still do not fathom the evolutionary logic blue eyes or blind people, for that matter. It is just a matter of time. We are all the same inside, and we all evolve slowly over the time to meet the need of our environment. It is also white people who move from remote nations, like Africa, will someday have descendants who are black. Believe it or not, the only difference in our race is that we adapt over the centuries to our environment. I hope that you have a better understanding of who you are in terms of physical differences and the effect of our environment. We are also spiritual people who also must understand the spiritual environment in which we choose to live. The inspection of their teeth, yes, strong and milky white. The compacted body muscles, yes, strong, fitted and well built. Look at his healthy eyes, black, strong hands and feet. Calling up Christ in the courtyard, soul, going once, going twice, going for the third time to master white.
fish on ships packed together like sardines in a pan and hustle away from our motherland. Over the big waters, going to unknown lands, fear for some, drunk but could not swim the sand. Faith for others, they held on with a sun and a plan. We shall overcome someday. The unknown made the known of true self, soul, and spirit. They would never be able to see each other again, was their cry in the motherland and in the unknown lands. But they never lost their connections, the beating of the drums, the trampling of the feet, the clamors of the grip of the unknown languages. The vibrations kept their connection, offsprings of their own, offsprings of our own, owned by the masters. Yet we kept our culture alive, the purpose by mixing our culture with the culture and produce something of our own. Some still call us by many names, shelters, tigers, erasure, shango, lionites, joylites, cocoa, quakers, shakers, and converts, but known to us and the world today as spiritual baptists, the faith of our fathers, who stood the task of our master's way in food, names, languages, and songs. Today we are holding on to our culture. Back home, yet away from home, to this purpose are we called. We were called to the purpose of spreading the gospel and a faith that is diverse than our big brother, who was called for a purpose because his work was different, his talk was different, his teachings was different, but to the purpose he was called. His name is Jesus. Our life today is patterned after our brother and savior, and to this purpose are we called. The purpose of our God, and so today we know who we are and where we are going. One of our brothers said, he had a dream. Today we have a dream, and it's surely reality. Another brother said, don't look upon me because I am black, for I am black, but come. His blackness brought to me wisdom, knowledge, and most of all understanding. We cannot change the color of our skin, neither can we change from being Africans. So to that purpose, you and I are called. I am strong. We are called to be brave. We are called to be children of the faith. So we are proud to be spiritual Baptists, doing the will of our Father, who has sent us. Yes, the waters has changed us, but it has washed us and made us whole. I have a renewed mind, and to this purpose are we called, to stand, stand, stand forever, stand like a bridge over water. Thank you.
That even when you don't see it in yourself, somebody sees it in you. And our next speaker is Sister Chanel. Oh, let's give her a round of applause.
Observe the topic. That was my first question.
are we ready for the battle? And then he came, not in him, but his son, King King. I have a sword in my hand. Help me to lose it.
Oh,
next speaker will be Shepherd Neverson. We'll give him a round of applause.
Church is for. The church is designed to teach articulate, educated people so that when you go out into the world, you can be able to give a good word of our God. That's what the church is for. But our duty is to go out into the world and preach that good news. And that's the better part about it. Somewhere along the line, like, we kind of lose that. We kind of shift away from it. We kind of leaving that behind. That is one of the things on the Baptist faith that I always used to like to see. I used to be up underneath my mother and my father, them and them by the side of the road, and then the ringing bell. I saw them boy between the legs. And I did, I know what I'm doing, I know what really going on my day. And that's what it is. They used to have plenty of that. Plenty of that. Nearly every weekend, you're out by the side of the road and you're preaching the gospel. But it seems like, you know, some of us become a little kind of complacent to the church. I mean, you know, we like to be in the church, we want to worship in the church, we want to praise, and nothing is wrong with that. Nothing is wrong with worshiping and praising in the church, but there are those who need the word on the outside. The Bible said that Christ came for the sinners. He came for those who need the healing, those of you who are in church. You already know, you have come to the understanding that Christ is our Savior, so that's why you are in church. But you need to go out there and speak to those who are not in the congregation of believers. And teach them, talk to them, preach to them, give them the word. What have we done with this, our Baptist faith? I want to speak a little bit on the youths, really, actually, because it's those youths we be dealing with. In the Old Testament, Joel in chapter 2, I think it's verse 20, he spoke about the young men will have visions and the old people will dream some dreams. Sons and daughters, they will prophesy. I want to tell the older ones who are here, get the young men more involved. Get them more involved in service. Get them more involved in the pilgrimage. Get them more involved in the mission. Get them more involved in mourning. Get them more involved in baptism. Take them in the water. Show them what you need to do before you survey. Show them things within the church. Because the young men will have the vision. The vision in the sense that they will know what the faith needs to move on. Nothing wrong with the older folks, and I respect the older folks. I have all authority to respect the older folks. I believe in the older folks. The Bible says when it is in you, you're healing, you take yourself to the elders of the church and you get yourself anointed. So I love the older folks and I believe in them. But the young men are the ones with the vision. These are the ones that is going to take the faith to our next level. Not taken away from the old things that we did in the past. I love it. I love Baptist. Give yourself a round of applause, because we worship the way we worship. There's no other way that the people don't worship like how we worship. We are a unique people and a unique faith. And I believe that we are chosen people. But getting young men more involved, and I guess that is why we don't see enough young men within the churches. Elders, don't embarrass the young men when they try. And I believe that's one of the things that kind of keep people from doing stuff within churches. Because a fear has become among the young people, because they don't want to get up and do anything, because they don't want nobody to tell them anything out of the way to embarrass them in front of people. I, for one, don't like embarrassment. So if you embarrass me once, bet your bottom dollar I will not do it again. I love the spirit of work within the young men and the young women within the church. I allow them to operate. If you find out somewhere wrong, you put them aside and you teach them. As you talk to people, what have you done with this? You want to kind of correct it. We want to take the spiritual practice faith to another level. We don't want to stay behind houses and underneath houses and hiding in places where nobody can see us. We want, of course, you take the word of God. We want us to have cathedrals. We want us to have big churches. Nothing wrong with closing up a big church and having an LAC and you enjoy yourself in worship. I know how the older folks feel. You want to sweat and you want to take off your shoes and you want to dance and prance, but however, we want to elevate ourselves. In churches, not only spiritual Baptist churches, we have educated people and lot of educated children. We have managers. We have IT specialists. We have electricians, mechanics. We have educated technical people in churches. We don't want to leave them behind. We want to use them, we want to lift them up, and we want to use them in a way we can build the churches. What have we done with this field? In James 1:27, it tells us that religion, true religion, it speaks about going and seeing about the poor, praying for the sick, dealing with your elders, going outside and dealing with those who are in need. James speaks about that as true religion. Let us not get too religious with our cultural practices within the church. We need to go out there and deal with those on the outside who are sick. I have a mom, my mom, she has a ministry and she goes to the hospital. Sometimes I just ask her and say, you don't want nobody else within, you know, your age bracket spiritually, who they can take with you on your journey. She just says, oh, don't worry about me. This is what God has placed within my heart, and I don't know what this God has given me, but I understand what true religion is. She does go to the hospital, she prayed for everybody from ward one to ward wherever I come in the hospital. She prayed. That's what my mom does. She goes out on the outside and she did. That is true religion. James spoke about it. 1:27, if it is, I want to read about it. That is true religion. Let us take ourselves back. We are spiritual people. I believe when you are on the ground, some of you all get the ministry for healing. I spoke to a mother this morning in church and she told me when she went on the ground, she got healing and stuff and things like that. And she turned to me and she told me, but I don't do that thing. Because I see people and people and people and people. But you went and God had given you the authority to heal his people. But you don't do it because of people. What have we done with this? Want to know what have we done with this?
You get a lot of joy. No.
Speak to me.
I thank God for being here. Thanks to the elders on whose shoulders we stand. Harmony can be defined as a relationship characterized by a lack of conflict or by agreement as of opinion of interest. Diversity can be defined as differences or variations of unlikeness. Worship can be defined as an act of religious devotion, usually directed towards God or a deity. In the spiritual Baptist faith, we, the practitioners, come from various cultures, ethnic groups, and socio-economic backgrounds. We hold different opinions. Some of us came from different religious backgrounds, beliefs and practices, merging together on a common ground called the spiritual Baptist faith. Within our based on our various convictions of spirituality, spiritualism, and the teaching that were passed on from generation to generation, even to this present day. However, while there is diverse in our forms of worship, there remains the most important element that harmonizes all, no matter what our beliefs and practices are, that there is but one God the Father, Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth. Our belief in God and His Word, that Word which David in Psalm 138 verse 2 reminded us that God Himself has magnified above all His name. That level of understanding brings us to a state of consciousness in our prayers, praise, and worship, which are directed to our Father in heaven. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 4 to 6 states, "Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are diversities of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but the same God which worketh all in all." We, the practitioners of the spiritual Baptist faith, embraces this doctrine which has led us, no matter where we come from, to harmonize within our diverse form of worship. Psalm 96, verse 9, tells us, "Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Fear before Him all the earth." The purpose of our worship is to glorify, honor, praise, exalt, and please God. Jesus says in John 4, 23 to 24, "But the hour is coming, and now is when true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship Him. God is spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth." Worshipping God in spirit means with reverence, attentiveness, and having the right purpose of honoring God while understanding what we are doing. Our worship must glorify God. 1 Corinthians 6 to 20 says, "For you were bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." We must worship God in truth. Since His word is truth, we must worship Him according to His will. For when we unite, there is harmony. And through harmony, we are strengthened to fight against the forces of the enemy. For a chain is as strong as its weakest link. At this time, I invite you to stand. Join with me in singing a verse of a well-known hymn. Thank you, and God bless.
Allow me to greet the clerical body of this birthland of my father, forefathers, in Trinidad and Tobago. And most of all, to all the youth within the hearing of my voice. Good afternoon. My job is rather easy today. The task was given unto me to speak to you, my peers, and also to all those present on the hidden treasures of the faith. What are hidden treasures? Hidden treasures are priceless items that have been lost or misplaced or even undiscovered. Items which hold value beyond value itself. Items that hold a history of time and a space, of time and a space where events of true power took place. The hidden treasures to a normal man or a normal woman would be that of gold, diamonds, rubies, platinums, all precious stones, and all precious metals. But to me as a youth, which my entire background is a spiritual Baptist, I have come across some treasures that I couldn't see if I wasn't in the faith or active in such a faith as this. Here is a few of the treasures that I always commemorate. One, our rich history of spiritual Baptists, our recorded events of trials and tribulations to be able to be functioning as a free entity today. All those women and men whose names are immortalized in our hearts forever. Two, the ancestral lineage and indigenous collaboration that we have access, that we have access to the fact that the Middle Passage wasn't just a boat ride down the Nile, but it was a birth ride into lands and countries where our identities as slave children had been transferred to save children crowned prince and princesses in Jesus' name. We get to travel to India, Africa, China, and all over the globe without a visa, plane ticket, or plane ticket, via the secret place also known as the inner court, or a more naked term, the motor room. Three, my final hidden treasure that I as a youth, I admire is the power and anointing of the elders that preceded us in this truly captivating faith. The ability they possessed to see and know things before it happened, to be able to also get information about a place that they never went to via train, plane, or boat. That spiritual accessibility to realms unknown that no other faith possess. We, the youth of the spiritual Baptist faith, should honor those that did what they did to enrich this faith, commend those that are still enriching the faith. Great men like my grandfather, the King Shepherd Davidson Canada, who through the guidance of the Spirit of God has us here today. We the youth of today should now bless those who the onus falls upon to shine, up those treasures, display those treasures, but most of all, become treasures of our next generation to be accessed. Thank you, Trinidad and Tobago.
I face my hopes upon my
own.
Track
I see
and I pursue. Narrow way to him I go. Narrow way
to him I go.
The prophets went.
Yes.
of holiness, of holiness.
Look for all his plans and peace,
and
first, acknowledging the Spirit of God in this place, let me take time to acknowledge the wonderful men and women of this magnificent faith. To all of you that's here today, my company in travel, the U.S. delegates, to
praise all Trinidad
and Tobago citizens, a pleasant good evening.
Good evening.
My topic for exaltation is, as we build, look out for detractors.
Yes.
And when I first got this topic, I was kind of confused because I didn't know what it was talking about. But my question today to the congregation is, I'm sure most of us know a contractor and how to build. And when I think of building, I think of Psalms 127 verse 1, which reads, "Except the Lord build a house, the labor is in vain that build it."
Yes.
So now after I read that, my thoughts escaped to the factors that contribute to building a house. And in order to build a house properly, you must have the following components. The first and foremost main component is a visionary, one who has been endowed with the vision from God. Next, you need a contractor, one who carries out the visionary's request. In addition to the contractor, you must have the project manager, one who supports the contractor's information received from the visionary. The contractor then employs trained men and laborers to do the work that supports the visionary's request. But like everything else, where there's a positive, there has to be a negative. When there's a contractor, there's a detractor. A detractor is an individual which criticizes something or someone, often unfairly. Anybody know some detractors in the field?
Holy Ghost.
Detractor or detractors interrupt not only the contractor, but the project manager, the laborers, and the tradesmen, but most dangerously, detractors distract the visionary. So we have to arm ourselves with the shared information of the visionary and the supporting cast to ensure that we, the recipients of the construction to be, would not be despoiled of the benefits of the project. The recipients of the construction to be would be us, the youth of today, the truth of tomorrow. As stated in 1 Timothy 4, verse 12, "Don't let anyone think less of you because you are young. Be an example to all believers in what you say, in the way you live, in your love, your faith, and your purity." Based on this verse, it's basically stated that don't let any individual draw you away from the Lord because of the negative statements they may make against us because of our young anointing. Timothy was a youth that was one of Paul's closest laborers. This same book of Timothy was written to give encouragement and instruction to Timothy. And as Timothy was constructing his way to the will of God, the elders were detracting and questioning everything that he did. In the faith, we have to look at detractors as obstacles that we have to overcome in order to succeed. To succeed, we must have and maintain a strong foundation that will be to identify our calling. After identifying the calling, you have to identify your gift and develop it thoroughly and dedicate yourself to your gift so that the elders would not question your anointing. Paul did not question Timothy because he saw his sincere faith from a child. As a youth, it is a lot easier for the elders to look down on us. Timothy had to earn the elders' respect by his speech, his life, love, faith, and purity. We as a youth of today need to apply that concept to our daily lives, earning respect from the elders by the way we carry ourselves and speak. As we build along the way, there may be detractors that criticize our age, the life we live, and such things. Regardless of your age, God can still use you. Yes, we are young, but Ecclesiastes 11 verse 9 states, "You who are young, be happy while you are young, and let your heart give you joy in the days of your youth. Follow the ways of your heart and whatever your eyes see. But know, that for all these things, God will bring you into judgment." So yes, as youth, we still have to enjoy our days, but know that we have to give account to everything that we do. As the saying goes, many are called, but few are chosen.
Yes.
So the elders cannot criticize who God has chosen to lead or assist in leading his flock. We cannot overthrow God's authority with what he wants to do. In conclusion, being a youth in Christ, we will now have to learn how to structure our lives to live for God. With everything, there is moderation along our youthful journey. There may be, as stated before, detractors that question our youthful anointing, but we as youth have to trust and believe in God. We have to be self-courageous to flourish our own anointing with the guidance of elders that are putting their trust in us to carry on the faith. In order to stay away from detractors and draw closer to contractors, we have to be mindful of everything that we do and say. In saying all of this, I want the youth of tomorrow to take heed of this word. Remember that the only way to stay away from the detractor is to stay focused on Almighty God.
By the name of Cicero that stated, the greater the difficulty, the greater the glory. We serve a God that does not give us gifts or abilities if we do not show a constant zeal in seeking his face, seeking out the hidden mysteries within. The word hidden is past tense for the word hide. When we have something valuable that we do not want anyone or anyone to see or touch, we would hide it away. Therefore, if someone wants to find it, they now have a mystery to solve. Anything that is hidden must be a treasure to someone. God put many treasures on the earth for our enrichment, survival, and to enhance this universe. And we must seek them, and we must seek to find them. For example, oil. People drill miles into the ocean to find this treasure that is a necessity to mankind. Have you ever wondered how this oil is made? That is a hidden mystery. Gold. We spiritual Baptist people, we love to wear a gold ring, gold chain, gold bracelets with all our garments. But have you ever thought, where does gold come from? Or how much trouble does gold miners go through to find this gold? Further, the process of defining gold is another mystery of purification. Pearls. In Japan, there's a separate beach full of oysters. If you drop one grain of sand into an oyster's mouth, in a matter of time, a pearl will be formed. Another mystery. There had to be a man or woman who first discovered these mysteries, but we will never know because they were never documented. The same scenario can apply to our faith. If we, the youths of today, are the leaders and money of tomorrow, how will we be able to preserve the future? The great leaders of today are those who we, the youths, must imitate and question in order to learn. But remember, always have respect. One leader within this faith that is a master of hymnals, trumpets, or music of a whole, our own Bishop Oswald Duncan. Bishop Oswald was able to seek the mysteries in music and different airs in which hymnals can be sung. However, he could not have done it by himself. He must have had a teacher. In order to become wise or gain knowledge, we must have a teacher. I say a teacher, meaning one.
Amen.
Let me give you a little scenario. If you are sitting in a seat, I want you to picture yourself sitting in a seat, and two men of God are standing in front of you. They both have a spoon, and a big piece of macaroni pie is on that spoon. And they both try to push that spoon in your mouth. Would you be able to eat? J.W. Gorthy says, no two persons regard the world in exactly the same way. Therefore, no teacher would ever practice the same exact rituals. There are many traditions that we Baptists perform and do not fully understand. Can you say, as of right now, that you know all the answers to our faith? If the answer is no, I recommend to seek the answers. As I come down, I want to open up your mind, hearts, and souls to some mysteries. The mystery of man. The Bible first talks about the creation of man in the book of Genesis, the second chapter. The seventh verse tells us that God formed man out of dust of the ground. Therefore, from this verse, we can come to the conclusion that God is the creator of man. But here is where the mystery begins. Our creator gives us instructions. We, man, are able to ignore him and say, I am not doing that. But when another man or another person tells us a commensurate story or bacchanal, we are not able to ignore. The mystery of the church. She is the bride of Christ. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 26. Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that we might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word. How can we say we are a church when on a Sunday the word is not being preached? The word of God is preached as a prophet, for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and the training of the righteousness. 2 Timothy, 3rd verse. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. Last but not least, the mystery of Jesus being fully God and fully man. This is a mystery to many people throughout all religions. Many wonder, how can Jesus become fully man? Jesus was not always fully man, but through the womb of Virgin Mary, Jesus was born. Jesus is the one, the person, the God. Jesus became man on behalf of you and I. We often hear that our lives were predestined, meaning that God knew us before we were even born. Therefore, he knew sin would occur in our lives. Jesus died on the cross for our sins. The hymn "There Is a Green Hill Far Away" tells us, he died that we might be forgiven, that we might go at last to heaven. In conclusion, when we seek the truth and gain a proper understanding in who we are and why we are placed on earth, we are destined for greatness. Mysteries will continue to be examined and solved by those who seek the answers within themselves. Every encounter with God is a confirmation of great things to come. Some things are to be left to God. I want everyone to repeat after me. Father, I stretch
my hands to thee.
No other help I know.
But if thou withdraw thyself from me,
whither shall I go? we have all just told God, I depend on you. So for all the hidden mysteries within my life, spiritually and carnally, God now knows them. And in a matter of time, deliverance shall come. Thank you.
My hands to thee, no other help I know.